Welcome, everyone. What a great turnout. We've got a full group today. I'm so excited. Thank you all for coming up and showing up to support Monica. Why don't you just go ahead and take the floor, Monica? I'd love for you to introduce yourself and all the amazing things that you do for the community.
Thanks so much, Terry. And thank you guys for your support today. I'm so excited to see so many of you. And I don't even have my fingers ready to see everybody's faces, but I promise to scroll through. I want to get to know each and every one of you. I put a few little things in the chat area. So if you want to read through those, it's just basic housekeeping. So, you know, I'm totally open. Please chat whenever you want to, whether it's verbally or written. Lauren is also gonna help us with that. If I miss any comments, she'll just read them out to me so that I can answer on the fly. If there's anything that you want repeated, either verbally, you know, orally, or you wanna see the hands-on demo piece of that again, please don't hesitate to ask. What else? Oh, sometimes I get kind of sketchy service out here. We've just moved from the Seattle area down to New Mexico. We're a little bit rural. If for some reason my connection leaves me, I will jump right back on. So don't you worry, but take that time to take a little bio break, do some stretches, use the restroom, or come up with some questions and comments or stories that you want to share. And when we come back, we'll just jump right back into things. So just a little bit about me. I'm a doula chef. I do birth and postpartum. And I just became a doula about 3 years ago. Long story short, my second child, who was adopted at birth, was the impetus and really the inspiration, both he and his birth mom, for why I became a doula. And a lot of that had to do with birth injustices for BIPOC women and girls. And I've just been waiting for the day to be able to be have my children be a little more independent. All four children are on the autism spectrum and have some other special needs. And so that was a pretty much a full-time job for about 17 years. But 3 years ago, I was able to realize that dream through Dona International. I took my birth and postpartum. And ever since then, I've been training with community birth workers and joining as many groups as possible and learning from the best of the best. And I feel really excited to be able, through their blessing and through their trainings and their knowledge shares, to be able to share in turn with all of you who are here today. So thanks again for showing up. I know your time is really important, and I want to make sure that I maximize the time with you. 2 hours seems like a lot of time, but it goes by really quickly. But the good thing is I'm a really quick cook. So if I'm doing things again too quickly for you, just ask. I'm going to throw a lot of ideas in there. I'm going to throw some cheats in there. I'm going to throw some anecdotes and stories in there as well while I'm cooking. So think of me as a less glorious Food Network host for the time being, but you get to interact with me, which, like, instead of yelling at the TV. Sometimes I'm a little cheesy. I was a chef instructor for high schoolers, so I had to keep it, like, really, you know, fun and up tempo and throw a lot of anecdotes in there. So if it's a little cheesy, just tune me out, and hopefully you'll take away some good things. So we could just skip through the bio. You're welcome to read that at your leisure. Let me see if I can. Oh, how do I scroll down, Terry? Oh, just with my document, you think? Oh, it's not letting me. I want to scroll down to the next page.
You can edit full screen and then just put all your tabs up again and then go to the actual document that you're sharing.
Okay, so I go to pause share for a second.
No, just exit full screen.
Oh, of the document?
At the top of the Zoom, there's view options. Should be.
Sorry, I'm new to this, guys. Yeah. Does anybody have their packet in front of them by any chance?
If you want to send it to me, I can do the digital part here.
And then that would be fantastic.
Do you want to just email it to me? I'll pop my email
in. Sure. Thank you guys for being so understanding here as we're working through this. Let's see.
Yeah. Earth workers aren't the most technical savvy.
Right. Terry, what's your email?
It's in the chat.
Do you need me to say it out loud or do you got it, Monica?
Yeah, could you say it out loud for me? I'm having trouble opening
it. Yes, yep. So terry.chi.lee@gmail.com.
Thank you.
You're welcome.
Sorry about that.
Okay, and I'm attaching.
I'll attach it as a Google link for everybody in the chat once I get it.
Fantastic. There was a question. Yeah, I sent to most folks that had asked, but we may have some folks on here who didn't get it. So here we go, sending away right now.
Great.
Okay, so I'm just gonna go through, and as you guys get an opportunity, you can look through those recipes. But I wanted to share some books first that really influenced the work that I do. So coming at this from a chef's point of view, the food piece was sort of easy, but like really connecting the dots with the nutrition and being really specific about how we nourish, particularly in the postpartum, really lent itself to the books that I read. So I think most people have heard of The First 40 Days, right? Amazing book. Thumbs up if you've gotten to browse through it, read it, use any of the recipes in it. Okay, the next book that's birth related, and this is one of my mentors. This is called Healing Meals, The Mommy Plan by Ibu Valerie Lynn. Has anybody had an opportunity to read through this one? Fantastic. Yeah, and this is mostly Malaysian inspired, so Southeast Asian. She has a lot of Thai, Vietnamese, even Chinese recipes in here, Ayurvedic Indian. And then this is another mentor of mine. This is Layla B. Rashid, and she does the Moroccan postpartum. Has anybody had a chance to read through this or take any of her classes? Great. She's got beautiful recipes in here as well. And then I come from a Latin American background, so I self-identify as Mestiza, Peruvian Indigenous, Polish American. This is my go-to Bible. I love my Latin American recipes, and it's a really good full scope of like Central South American. So these are my books. If anybody wants these, the titles to these, I'll write these in the chat during our first bio break. So one of the first things I do whenever I'm getting ready to cook or do anything is a little thing I learned in culinary school, which is mise en place. And it's the French term for everything in its place. And I really love that concept, just generally, right? For anything that we do in our lives. And the mise en place for cooking is gonna include things like your ingredients, your utensils, your pots and pans, any supplies that you're gonna be using, your herbs and spices, et cetera, et cetera. And if I can, I like to prep those. If I know I have like a long day of cooking, so for some of you who are birth workers, particularly postpartum in the home, you might be preparing meals. Most of us do it on the fly. It's sort of like we arrive at the home. When we start asking questions about how birthing person and baby and family are doing, we often realize, and the birthing person does in that moment, oh, hey, I forgot to eat today. I'm really hungry. I didn't realize that until you got here. And so we sort of like throw things together on the fly, like make sure they get a sandwich or a salad or, you know, a really good drink, a beverage, make sure they're hydrated. And so what I want this course to kind of, or this workshop to kind of do is give us some ideas right off the bat, help us to be pre-planning and thinking ahead of time, helping us to have that discussion before we ever walk into the home. Like, why is nutrition important? Why are, you know, these five pillars of postpartum important? Why is what I call the OWL, organic, lactogenic, and what does the W stand for? Does anybody know? You can unmute if you want to. Let me grab this real quick. Do you guys have the screenshots yet?
do you want to go ahead and unshare your screen, Monica? And then that way when you're presenting, we'll be able to see a bigger view of you. And then everyone should have the link.
Okay, so if I pause the share like that.
Stop share screen.
So I'll go over to more. It's not giving me something that says stop share screen. It just gave me resume share or pause share. Oh, stop share. Here we go. Does that work for you?
Mm-hmm. And then we'll be able to see everything that you're doing a little bit bigger.
Okay, perfect. Thank you.
If it's a Google Doc that you shared, Monica, you might have to give people access. It's like anybody that has the link is able to get into it, because it seems like some people in here are saying that they need access to the Google Doc. So that might just be the only thing.
It's a Word doc. People.
Yeah. That might be the
it's
only thing.
It's not Google.
Okay.
Yeah. So anybody who signed up through the website, I sent them in an attachment all of the docs so they could have that ahead of time.
I'll probably try and add that in the group chat, because I think it's the Google Docs that's in the link. Let me send that.
Okay. Thank you.
Yeah, so, everyone should have access to that document now.
Thank you so much, guys. So the W stands for warming. Does anybody have a concept of, like, maybe you've heard these terms thrown around in either birth circles, postpartum work, or maybe in your studies of Ayurvedic or Eastern medicine? The idea of cold states of being and warm states of being or hot states of being. Would anybody like to venture some info on that? You can go ahead and unmute yourself and just share away. Okay, so.
I figured it out.
Yes, please do.
Sorry, my kids are listening to shows in the background over here. I've had a lot of traditional Chinese medicine work done and acupuncture related to menses. And a lot of that was involved being warm, especially like keeping my like womb area and lower back warm. And so with the postpartum period, kind of like pulling into that as well. And also in some of my training with doing placenta medicine, there's a little bit of that in there too, where, you know, traditional Chinese medicine ways are using warming spices. And I've even had somebody tell me, oh, my TCM provider doesn't want me to have any more warm qi, so don't use those herbs when doing it. So it's a little bit of my experience with it.
Thank you for sharing. It's absolutely an idea, a concept, a medicine, a way of practicing medicine that's not only limited to the Eastern part of the world anymore. It's part of the vernacular now, or it's becoming more known. And so what we do know about it is the wisdom that's been passed down for generations by our birth workers, by our medicine peoples. And so warming is really important because your body is in different states depending on which processes it's going through. So during pregnancy, for example, your body is in a hot state. And if you think about it, it makes a lot of sense. Your body is creating, and creation is it's like, you know, burning calories a lot. It's making new fluids. It's providing nourishment, right? By taking away from your own. And so your body is continuously working day and night to sustain this other person. And when we go through labor and delivery, that even amps it up, right? So a lot of us birth workers were really puzzled why in Western medicine, doctors are like, don't eat, don't drink, you know. I mean, we understand that if there's, you know, a situation where they might have to go into surgery, that they don't want them to have anything that they could bring up, right? We get that. But if we're having, you know, a fairly natural occurring birth, it makes sense that we should be sustaining that person by feeding them and giving them beverages and keeping them going for the long road ahead. So when we transition out of that labor and delivery state, pregnancy, labor and delivery state, we transition into what we call the fourth trimester. We call it, what are some other words that we call that?
Antepartum.
Antepartum, great. So has anybody heard of the quadantenna? So if you know your Latin, you hear quad means what? 40. Well, it means four, but you know, moving into the 40 days, the first 40 days. So why 40 days or 40, 45 days? Does anybody know why many cultures practice the postpartum for such an extended period of time? And when I say extended, that's really relative, right? It's relative to what we do here in the West. Why do we have such a long period of time? I like that, Alyssa, because it's necessary. Yes, it's just plain and simple because it's necessary. Yes, our wise people knew that. They knew that somebody had spent the better part of 9+ months gestating this human and going through all of these radical changes, right? And to think that right after delivering, the work is done and now your body's just going to go back to normal miraculously somehow, and all the processes are going to reverse themselves, and this dinner plate sized scar that you have in your womb from your placenta coming off and all of the blood and fluids that you've lost, that suddenly and miraculously it's all going to pop back into place and you're going to be ready and raring to go 3 days later. Most people give themselves 3 days or a week, right? Does that seem realistic? How do you guys feel about that? I see some no's, right? Yeah, so anybody who's been through pregnancy and delivery might have had that mindset before. Maybe that was something that was just passed down in your family, like, hey, you know, we just bounce back. We just go back to things as normal. And, you know, you got to do what you got to do. You got to cook, you got to clean, you got to feed anybody else in the family. That's your responsibility. So just, you know, pick right back up where you left off. Did anybody go through that period having those thoughts themselves, or have you heard that from other people that you've worked with? I definitely know that I have. I hear that all the time. And when I was first a doula, I felt like I was trying to convince people, like I'm this woo-woo she-she person, and I'm trying to convince them of why this is so important to take this time and just surround themselves with people who are going to care for them during those first few days so that they can take a back seat. And actually they're taking a back seat to the work around them, but what they're actually doing is putting themselves ahead of all of that and making sure that they have that time and space to heal both body, mind, and soul, right? So, what are we going to learn about today? I've called it the OWL, organic, warming, lactogenic. Lactogenic means milk producing. Okay. So we're going to learn the 5 pillars of postpartum care. And while I teach that, I'm actually going to start cooking because we need to get stuff on the stove. So let's talk about the first pillar. Who sees that? Go ahead and just read it out to me. Anybody feel comfortable reading out that first pillar?
Yeah, first pillar says rest for up to 45 days immediately after giving birth.
Okay. What do you think about that? What are your thoughts?
I think we need more than 45 days to rest realistically, but I guess 45 is a good start.
I love that. You're shooting for this moon and the stars and the galaxy. That's fantastic. And yes, people around the world, cultures that have been able to hold on to that wisdom, they do know that. this is a very prescriptive amount of time. We're just saying, at the very least, can you try? Can you shoot for those 40 or 45 days? We know that that's the base, right, of being able to heal from most of the things. Now, if you've had a cesarean or you've had an otherwise difficult pregnancy and birth, or maybe this is just the way you're made up, you may have some co-occurring situations, right, that are going on within your body, it absolutely may take longer. And I've heard of people that it's taken a year or two to rebound. However, most people that I hear that say, you know, with my first child, it really took me a good year or two to rebound and to feel like myself. Do a lot of these things sound familiar? Like, and I really don't want to go through that again, and I don't know how to speed that up. Well, I don't know that speeding up is what we really should be promoting per se as doulas, as birth workers. But what I will say is what everybody had in common, the reason it took so very long in most cases is because they either didn't have access to, or the ability to, or the knowledge to, or the supports to do that work for themselves in those first 40 days, okay? So let's not assume that people aren't doing it because they don't see the validity in it. I mean, there are single parents out there. There are people who are not close to relatives and family members who don't have large support systems. And remember, for the past 3 years, we've been living in a pandemic, right? So this is sort of the first time in history where mass amount of peoples have been birthing and then caring for themselves and their infants without any ability to have outside support in their home, or very little, right? Folks who have to go back to work, absolutely. As we know in the United States, not all jobs are created equally, and there is not, what should I say? I try to think of the nicest word possible, but let's just go with, like, not everybody has the right to stay home for more than 6 weeks with their child. And that may not even be about the job. It may be about, you know, the financial piece that they do need to get back. They're the sole breadwinner, or, you know, their salary is really important to the maintenance of the family. And so they feel that they do have to go back sooner. So these are conversations that are very real and they're very raw, but they're things that we can start as soon as we get hired, or as soon as we have conversations with prospective clients, or as soon as we start talking to other birth workers and other birthing people, we can say, so let's prepare. How can we best prepare for this time? What are some things that we can put into place right now that will help you have the best first 40 days, no matter what your circumstances are? Like, anything's better than nothing, right? So let's try to plan and think of those things. I'm going to take a pause here because I want to show you around. Like I said, if you get seasick, I hope this doesn't disturb you. Just shut your eyes, go la, la, la. But I want to show you, when I talked about that mise en place, everything in its place, how I've structured the day. Now, it's a little bit like uber organized because I'm teaching today. But even when I go into somebody's home, I'm always going to get all of my supplies at the ready, out of the fridge, out of the pantries, lay them out, get all of my utensils ready, get all of my pans ready, so that it's just a real quick run through. And in that way, I can also cook or prepare multiple things at the same time. Okay, so I'm going to show you my little workspace right now. I've got my meats, my veggies. I've got my this way. I don't know if this is upside down or not. I've got all my spices. I've got my greens. I've got stuff out on my stovetop ready to go. I've got my sink cleared of dishes, which never happens in my home, by the way. I have four teenage boys who are constantly piling things up. I've even got my canning jars ready for that golden broth soup that we're going to be doing. What else? Oh, I've got my prep station ready for our warming drinks. And I've got my tea stations ready. And I've got my bowls, utensils, everything ready to go. So, does anybody else cook like this? Does anybody do like meal planning for their families, like where they cook multiple meals in a day? Alyssa, that's you. Okay, great. So it can seem really intimidating at first, but I promise you, like people literally, when they watch me cook, they're like, oh my gosh, how are you doing it so fast? Okay, well, I am gonna thank my education for that, because like we had horrible toxic chefs who were always screaming down at us, telling us to do it faster and like not waste anything. But at the same time, when you cook for a large amount of people, you have to do it quick. You have to do it efficiently. You got to save pennies where you can. Those meal prep days are pretty much necessary around here. I hear you. I hear you, Lizzie. Okay, so I'm going to actually push my computer down so you can see my hands at work. If you can't see something well, or you're only seeing my big old tummy, just let me know so I can adjust it. Multiple meals in a day, but meal plan for the week. Very good. And that's something that we can absolutely do with our clients. If you don't feel comfortable cooking, if that's not your forte, that's okay. The things I'm going to show you today are pretty simple. I'm going to talk about a few ideas at the very end where how you can pre-do these things, or you can even have the family prep some of these things on their own so that they're ready for you when you get there. Okay, so I'm going to, let's see. Can you see my hands well here? Awesome. Okay, so let's show you this. It looks like a bucket of slop. It looks like it's ready to go out to the garden, right? So these are my scraps. Some people call it compost. That's great. You know, I will compost some of this for my gardens, but a lot of these scraps I'm gonna save for my stocks, okay? So you don't have to use a bunch of fresh veggies. As you're cooking throughout the week, get yourself a baggie or a container and save things like stems off your parsley and cilantro. Save, you know, your halves of lemon that are getting a little bit, you know, crusty. Save those mushrooms that started to shrivel up on you before you could use them all. Save the ends, the skins, the hearts of things like onions, the peels of carrots. These are all, like I said, the skins are great. I'm going to do skins and the whole of garlic as well. These are going to go into a mesh bag. It's going to go into a cheesecloth bag that we're going to be making today. So I got most of this prepped. I don't have to like chop it up and make it look pretty, because it's literally going to go in a sack and be tied up, and it's going to be dropped into our cooking liquid. Okay, so that's most of my stuff. But I wanted to, for anybody who's never done raw garlic, if you're like me, I'd love to cheat. Like, this is so easy, you could just squirt it in, but so much cheaper to get, you know, the real thing. And then I have the ends to use or for like roasting or whatever. So I'm gonna take it, this is called a chef's knife. I'm gonna take a big chef's knife. I'm gonna lay it flat on top of the garlic. I'm gonna take the palm of my hand on the thick part of the knife. I'm gonna lift my fingers up and I'm gonna slam down, okay? One, two, three, slam down. And now it's easy to crack apart. Now we're gonna do the same thing. If you're like, how the heck do you get, do I need one of those Pampered Chef things to get the garlic out? No, you don't. Okay, so I'm gonna take this again, heel of my hand, I'm gonna squish. And then I can easily take the paper off. Where's the paper gonna go? Right into my scrap pile. Now, if I wanna, I am gonna use garlic later in the recipe. So one thing for safety, I talk about the cat's claw. Have you guys heard of the cat's claw when you're cooking? That's to keep all of your fingers away from the cutting edge of your knife. So I'm gonna take this and I'm gonna slice it first one way. Then I'm gonna turn and I'm gonna go the other way. And depending on how small you want it, you can go even smaller. I kind of like chunky garlic, that's just me. Now, if I wanted like a fine paste or whatever, I take a little bit of salt, sprinkle it on, and then I'm just gonna, can you hear that knife rasping and it's kind of breaking it apart? And that salt is working like sandpaper. So it's helping me to get a finer, and I would have diced that a little bit smaller, but you get the point. So I'm just gonna throw that in my scrap pile as well. Okay, I'm going to do my carrots now. If I have multiple of something, I like to line them up and just cut the edges. So I just do it all in one fell swoop, turn them, one fell swoop. There we go. Now that's done. Can you imagine? Peel, 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 cut each individual thing. Don't need to do it. Now I can line those up again and I can start cutting my rounds. And you see how I'm using that cat's claw, and I'll just move stuff out of the way and keep on going. So does anybody know the health benefits of carrots? You can see here I have purple, white, and traditional orange. What's in orange vegetables that's so good for us? Anybody say beta carotene yet? All right, these carrots are going in here. This is for my stews later. I'm gonna use them in both. So let's turn to the next page where we talk about, let's see what page that is. 1, 2, 3, 4. Let's turn to page 4 where we see lactogenic food list. So lactogenic again is that milk producing. So let's look at some of the foods that make that list. Dark green leafy vegetables, okay? These are fantastic sources of calcium, iron, vitamins, minerals, enzymes. Blood builders, think about how much blood they've lost. We wanna build that blood back up. Grains, what do grains do for us? It specifically targets the prolactin secretion, that hormone responsible for milk production. So some go-to grains that I love to use are oats. I mean, and oats can go in anything. They can be hidden in meatloaves and meatballs of any kind of meat, or even vegan, vegan alternatives, right? Barley, oats, millet, brown rice is fantastic to serve on the side of whatever dish you're making. Legumes, omega-3 fatty acids, transfers directly into the breast milk after consumption and helps baby's brain power, brain development. Okay, so today, let's see, let's go back a second. Our green leafy vegetable list, you'll see that I'm using, what grain did I choose for today? Oh, baby bok choy. I love baby bok choy, they're so cute. I mean, I love big bok choy too, but baby bok choy are just adorable. So that's gonna be our green for today that we're gonna be using. Our grains, we're gonna be using some oats later in our atoles, which are a warming drink. For our legumes, we're gonna be using lentils today.
Oh no, I must have lost her. Was everybody able to open the document from the Google link?
Oh, can you hear me again?
Oh, there she is.
Okay, hi, sorry about that. So I was saying for our legumes, we're gonna be using lentils and chickpeas today in our Moroccan stew. Nuts and seeds. Boy, we've got lots of options today. We're doing some sesame oil. We're using coriander as a spice. We're using almond milk and some chopped almonds today in one of our drinks. For orange root vegetables, we just talked about that beta carotene, which is great for lactation. So we're doing some carrots and sweet potatoes. Dried fruits, no dried fruits today, but in that Moroccan stew, if I had my dried apricots, I would absolutely throw it in, but my kids hate them. So I'm forcing them to eat this for dinner tonight. Oils and fats. Oh, we're gonna use lots of good oils. We're gonna do avocado, we're gonna do olive, we're gonna do some sesame oil. So these meals that we're making and these warming beverages are gonna be so good for that lactation. Okay, they're going to be so good for nourishing that body, warming that body, and really replenishing everything that's been lost. Let's go back to our five pillars. So I'm going to get this soup in. I'm just going to talk as I go. Please, if there's any questions, let me know as I'm going. But the second thing is nutrition, which we've talked a lot about today, warming, nutritious, lactogenic beverages and meals, which are going to support specific dietary and hormonal needs during the fourth trimester, okay? A lot of hormones rushing in, right? And we're reversing processes, okay? So we want to keep people as on an even keel as possible. And part of that nutrition is like, they're expending so many calories, especially if they are breast or chest feeding, right? That we really want to keep them going, that motor going. We also want to make sure that if they have any specific dietary needs, that we know about those. So it's really good to do a food quiz before you cook for anybody, unless you know you're really not cooking, you're just prepping something, like warming something up that they've already had made. It's still good, irregardless, to know that. So you can know the signs if they're going, like if they're diabetic, or you know, they are, what's the opposite of diabetic? I can't remember the word. I just forgot the word right now. Thank you. Yeah, those dietary restrictions. People love you to just ask the question. Just ask the question. Even if they give you a short response, some things that they do, some things that they don't, some things that they really don't like as far as beverages, at least just so you know, right? Okay, so the next one is massage. Do we have any massage therapists or body workers? And if so, could I ask you a few questions? Anyone on here? Lauren, are you a body worker? I can't remember.
Yes, I am. I was just seeing if anyone else wanted to chime in. I'm just kind of hanging out in the background.
Anybody else want to, or should we let Lauren be in the hot seat? So Lauren, why do you think massage in particular work on the belly is important as part of?
Oh yeah, a good uterine massage, helping with any bleeding, clotting, helping with pelvic floor support, just navigating the uterus shrinking back down to its original size postpartum.
Thank you. Those were like, I could not have said it better myself. Thank you so much for sharing that.
Oh, you're very welcome.
Yeah. And so one of the things that body workers will use, you know, obviously most body workers use some sort of oil that they prefer. But when we're working in the postpartum, we really want to also take the incorporation of warming into the physical application of the oils. So the actual oil and the body work that's being done, that causes friction, right? Which is causing heat. Great. Let's amp that up with oils that are warming. So what kinds of things could we add to the oils to make them warming, especially in the belly region?
Maybe like some cinnamon, some ginger maybe.
Ginger, lovely. We always use ginger in our oils. Great. Anybody else? And there are some oils that just by nature are more warming, and sesame oil is one of them. And I know that sounds funny to incorporate sesame oil, but you're going to use a carrier oil anyway. You're just going to put, you know, a few drops into your carrier oil. Great. Another thing that we can do besides using our hands for manipulation is we can use warm stones. Has anybody ever had a warm stone massage or had warm stones placed on parts of their body? How delicious does that feel? Yeah, I love it too. Okay, I'm gonna show you onion prep. So this was a whole onion. there are a million ways to cut an onion. I like to cut from top to bottom all the way through. And then it has a natural flat surface, so I lay them down. Now I'm going to cut the ends off of each one. Where are those ends going to go? Shout it out.
In your scraps.
Into my scraps. Compost or scraps or both, right? I'm going to peel that first layer off. That goes into my scraps. And now what's really great about onions is they have lines. They tell you where to cut them. If you have a really thick onion like I do today, you're going to start with a vertical cut. No, sorry, horizontal cut. You see how my hand is out of the way? Okay, now I'm going to do my vertical cuts going around into slices. So let's say I've got all my slices. Sometimes they'll stay together a little nicer than that, but if they don't, you can just pile them back up. No big deal. Pile them back up, and then we'll start cutting through them to make our dice. You can make a fine dice, which is smaller. You can make a large dice. It's really weird sitting down and cutting. Like, I don't have the same body mechanics I'm figuring out right now, but okay. So those are my onions. Right now, I've got everything I need to make my bouquet garni, just a fancy French term for sack of stuff. So I'm gonna cut a square out of my cheesecloth. It's what cheesemakers use, you know, to drain stuff. You may use it as well. I'm just gonna double layer it. So I want it to have some permeability, but I don't want stuff to fall out. I'm gonna remove those. Now, if anybody remembers, I said I just moved. And I cannot place half of my stuff. And one of the things I could not place was my butcher's blind. So I went into my sewing area and I was like, well, I think thread is gonna be too thin, but what about this? Has anybody seen Bridget Jones, Diary of Bridget Jones? Do you guys remember when she was making that first dinner and she had some like blue butcher's twine and it made everything like a blue slop? Yeah, me too. That's what I picked first. And I was like, oh yeah, I don't want to be like Bridget Jones. I'll pick white thread. So that's what we're going to use today, the white thread. So I don't have dye come off. So I'm just going to get a decent amount right there. And I'm going to start loading. So here's all my yummies. I'm just gonna take a handful and I'm gonna load them in. I definitely want a lemon in there. Some onions, some of those mushrooms, those skins, and that's good for now. Then I wanna take my peppercorns, which I forgot to bring over. Peppercorn, where are you? I'm still here. I'm looking for my peppercorns. Okay. I'm just going to have to unscrew my peppercorn thing because I can't find my jar of it. I'm just going to put a little handful in, like so. Put a bay leaf in there, and you're good to go. So now we're going to pull up the edges like this, pull up those edges, pull up those edges, get your hand down in there like you're making a ponytail, twist it a little, just wrap that string around. Tie it off, make a good knot, and we're going to drop that in with our chicken. So there we go, bouquet garni. So next we're gonna work on our chicken. So I told you that organic is one of our priorities. Why organic? Let's go to that page. Why is organic a an important part of cooking in the postpartum period. Anybody have any ideas?
Maybe because you don't want like some bad chemicals or like anything genetically modified. You just want to keep everything like as natural as possible.
Absolutely. Anybody else have another reason why?
Seeing that so many things can interact with our hormones, that just wondering if during that period of our hormones already trying to like recalibrate, limiting the things that can impact that.
Very good. Yeah, so we want to avoid the risk of being contaminated, right? You know, I don't know if anybody else has had this difficulty. I have found it virtually impossible to go completely organic. Like there are just certain things that either I really like the flavor of, their comfort foods, or you just can't find organic, right? So we do the best that we can. Chicken, easy to find organic. Most vegetables, easy to find organic. Let's talk about access and pricing though. Has anybody been to Whole Foods lately? Yes, especially in this economy. Really super tough, isn't it? I went to Whole Foods yesterday and I hadn't been in a spell. And oh my gosh, my bill was a little bit outrageous. Now I did get some like really fun stuff and stuff that I'll use for a while. But what I couldn't find at the farmer's market and use my EBT, and yes, I have EBT and I use it and I'm proud of it. I go to farmer's markets and I double my money on that EBT and get double what I could at a grocery store or, you know, just being at a normal farmer's market. So, yeah, I mean, there are ways that we can save on those organics, shopping local, shopping at your local farmer's market. Community gardens are another way to get those organics for cheap. Maybe put a little sweat equity in there. How about having your own garden? What do you think about that? Anybody have their own garden that they like to work in? Taking the guts out, putting the neck back in. By the way, does anybody eat the innards of the chicken? Are there any yeses to that? I can't read the comments right now. So I'm rinsing off the chicken. Even if it's organic, I like to give it a good little rinse. And then I'm gonna give it a good little pat as well. So I'm gonna bring that back over. There we go. Get some paper towels. Yeah, this is not a job for a cloth towel because you don't want that sitting around breeding salmonella. This is like a disposable. I even do the cavity. Just, you know, packaging, little juices sitting around. We don't need any of that. And I also dry it because I'm going to try to get a little bit of a sear on it. So what you didn't see is I already started my Instapot onto the soup broth mode. So it's warming. I can smell that it's warming. As soon as I wash my hands, I'm gonna put some olive oil down in it. And then I'm gonna sear the chicken on both sides. I'm gonna use a pair of long tongs. And then I'm gonna throw the water over it and the bouquet garni. Okay, so let me wash my hands real quick. If you wanna take a little break, ask any questions, please. Can somebody read those questions? I can see them popping up.
Oh, we're just having conversation right now about micro farming in the chat. No worries, we're listening too.
Love it, love it, love it. Farming, just like out of curiosity.
Sorry, I have a fussy baby, but micro farming is just smaller scale farming. So we don't mass produce, but our goal is to produce enough for ourselves and our community. this year without growing yet. So I grew up on a 20-acre farm out in Enumclaw and spent most of my life learning about the harmful, you know, the harms with mass production. And decided that I didn't want to be a mass farmer, if that makes sense.
Absolutely. Absolutely. Because with that comes kind of the need, in essence, right, to use pesticides or to conform to a certain way of farming to make it sustainable for you, right, as a farmer to make money. Is that correct?
Right. And then also it's mass producing farming material can be really harmful for the environment, you know, herbicides aside, but you're just taking up a lot of land. And if you're not doing it properly and not rotating your crops, then you're just depleting the soil. And then the surrounding soil is affected as well. And as well as just natural livestock, you know, deer, elk. It's so complex. There's so much to it.
Thank you for sharing that with us. We've had a garden for several years, but I feel relatively new to the concept of micro farming and community gardening and farmers markets, and why, like, that's not only good for us as far as eating and like supporting the community, farmers or whatever, but land management, soil management, and all of that good stuff too, right? So there are many reasons why we do it. Okay. Gosh, I've got my dogs under my feet. They just love being in the kitchen when I'm cooking. All right, so I'm gonna get that bouquet garni in. I'm gonna drop it right in, like plop it in, and then I'm gonna fill the water line. It's gonna be about 7 to 8 cups, and that's just gonna depend on whatever vessel you're using. So today I'm using the Instapot. That's my cheat. But you can absolutely use a large pot with a tight fitting lid. You could also use a slow cooker. Does anybody have a preferred method for making bone broth?
I love doing it old school on the stove.
Yeah, right? Does anybody roast their bones? Anybody roast bones?
I typically roast them, but that's just how my grandma did it.
Uh-huh. Yeah, in culinary school, it wasn't considered like a good stock unless you roasted the bones. But I'm too short on time for that. I'm not about that. And my Peruvian grandparents, this is how they made it, like stovetop. You throw everything in the kitchen inside of that pot and it's all good, right? Okay, so I got the water in now. I'm gonna close up, I'm gonna add just a little more salt and pepper, my little garlic, and apple cider vinegar. Anybody know why we do that? Anybody use apple cider vinegar when making stock or bone broth? I use garlic too. So there are several reasons that I use it. One is flavor, it gives it a little punch, but secondly, the vinegar draws out like the fats and the marrow, like makes it softer. I see a yes. What was that a yes to, Andy?
Oh, I think Asa had said that it helps to pull the minerals out, and I was to say that, but didn't want to. I feel like I'm speaking a lot today, so I'm just going to sit quietly and observe.
Oh, you're good. If you didn't see that, I'm adding turmeric. How do you guys pronounce it? Everybody I know pronounces it differently. So I'm going to put about a tablespoon or so in. And you can use fresh turmeric. But here's the crazy thing, both at the Asian market and at Whole Foods, I could not find a hand of ginger or turmeric. Is that not crazy? Like, how did that happen?
I feel flu season.
Oh, sorry.
Is that?
Oh, no, I'm sorry. I was just saying it's flu season. Everybody's sick.
You know what? I couldn't find celery either. I was thinking, is everybody making like smoothies or like decoctions or something? Like, what is up with that? So we're doing the sans, some of those things. We'll just, you know, do the best that we can. Oh, ginger, right. So I do have powdered ginger. And in a pinch, like today, we're just going to use powdered ginger. And that's fine and good. It'll get the job done. This is all about, like, we're doing the best that we can with the resources that we have. You're going to go into some homes, and, like, all they're going to have is salt and pepper and ketchup, and you're going to have to figure that crap out, right? Or, like me, you're going to have your Mary Poppins bag full of goodies, and in your Mary Poppins bag or in a cooler bag now is going to be your favorite seasonings and spices for what you know you want to make for them. Maybe you're going to have some of these other ingredients that I'm going to tell you about just so they're on hand and ready to go. And maybe you're like, wow, that's a lot of cost for me to incur, and that's a lot of my own supplies to use. Yes, that is accurate. And how do you make that sustainable? What do you think, guys? How can we make that sustainable?
You can like give your clients like a little shopping list and have them buy that stuff.
Great. Love it. What else? How about if we just do a little upcharge? A nominal upcharge, right? I mean, look, if people, food is the way to win people over. Almost everybody I know, food is the way to their heart, and that makes them feel really loved. Food really speaks to people, right? So if you're like, hey, when I come into your home, if you haven't eaten or if you'd like this as a service, I'd really love to make you some atoles, like a warming drink, or bring some teas to you, or, you know, make you a nice bone broth that you can store in the refrigerator for the rest of the week. Okay. And if you don't have time to shop, I understand. If Instacart, whatever, doesn't sell this one thing that we need, that's okay. Let me grab it. I'll bring it, or I've got some extra at home. And my up, you know, whatever, my upcharge is this, or don't even mention the upcharge and just put that into your package price, right? Think about what that would be if and when you have to cover those kind of expenses. And then it's not like you're being greedy and being like, oh, I'm charging you such and such to bring galangal and chili peppers, right? Just package it up. All right, so while that's going, we're gonna let that go for about 20 minutes. While that's going, let's finish with our five pillars of postpartum care. So we made it through rest, that's number one. Nutrition is number two. Massage was number three. Oh, let's go back to massage for a second. Huge proponent of using cloth as a massage technique. What can I be talking about? How could we be using cloth for massage?
You can use the rebozo for massage and stretching and support, like back support and all the things.
All the things. Thank you, Terry. So let's talk about the rebozo for a moment. Let's give it its due time. And by no means do I want to take, you know, a very long time with it, but I do want to give it its respect. So the rebozo comes from Latin America, specifically Mexico and Central America, although it has been widely used, but by a different name throughout South America, not only in the Latin American parts, but it's been used across the world, but it's been called different things. Okay. Anybody know any other words for a woven cloth used for all of those reasons that Terry suggested? Lauren, I know you are familiar with a bunch.
I
I'm sorry, can you repeat the question? I was currently replying to a client.
Oh, no worries, no worries. So we're talking about woven cloths and how those can be used. Terry gave us a good rundown of how woven cloth can be used in massage or for support. And so we know the rebozo is one cloth, sacred cloth, mm-hmm. woven cloth. Do you know the names of any other types of cloths that are used?
Yeah, like the muslin fabric that we use for Malaysian belly binding. And then there's also, I want to say, I forget the name of the fabric right now. I'm drawing a blank. It's like on the tip of my tongue, but it's a Yoruba. And it's what we use in African belly binding as well. And I'm drawing a blank on the name right now.
Yeah, thank you. Yeah, so there are different parts of the world, and I'll speak to the ones that I'm trained in. So Mexican, Latin American, we use the rebozo or the manta. In Peru, it's called a manta. And then in Malaysia, it's called bengkung. Those are those beautiful rat tummies that you see with the knots that go up like a spine on the front of the tummy. And often they use a really long, yes, it also means blanket. Absolutely. Thank you. So different kind of cloths, different kind of weaves, and they're very artisanal. They've traditionally been made by certain families for millennia. And you'll see some are used for baby wearing, some are used for binding purposes, some are used for manipulation during birth, and in stretching postpartum. Some are used in various, some are used as to hold on to during birthing and laboring, right? Where was I going with this? I had another one I wanted to share. I have one from Michoacan. Yes, that's a great, I feel like Michoacan is sort of the set. Oh, thank you, Marisol. Oh my gosh, is that the peacock one? Oh my gosh. So you see the fringe on that? Oh, so every family also has their own designs that they use. They have their own wools that they use or cottons. And even now some acrylics are making their way in. Some people like them because they're stretchier. I don't care for them, I like natural. Some have their own dyes, their natural dye colorants recipes. So this is an art form. And it's also something that we need to culturally respect where it comes from, who teaches it, the ancestral line and the ways in which it's used, because it is a sacred cloth. Yes, thank you, Marisol. We really appreciate you showing that. I didn't bring mine out to show today, but thank you. So whichever way you learn, make sure that you learn first from a person who is of that culture, okay? Or who has been gifted that knowledge to share with others through that culture, okay? Secondly, make sure that when you purchase one, you purchase it from the people of that particular region where you learned, or support families who are making them, okay? So do we wanna buy them from Amazon? Probably not, because you're not going to find it the way we're talking about finding it, okay? Third, respect the cloth. Should you have your cloth laying on the floor? Should you have your cloth just strewn about, or not being conscientious of it? No, this is the cloth is so sacred, it has a life of its own. And typically the people who use rebozos, mantas, bekungs, they wear these things, or sarongs, they wear these things, and it takes on their essence, and then the way they treat it is also the way it treats them in response, if that makes any sense. The name of Yoruba?
Yeah, so I just remember the name, so it's Asoke. It's the name of the Yoruba fabric we use in Nigeria.
Beautiful, beautiful. Yeah, and there's different prints. It's just, when you start to delve into the world of sacred cloths and how they're used and how they're respected and what the mind-blowing amount of ways to support birthing and postpartum people with it, it's so incredible that These truths haven't been lost because there are a lot of reasons for it not to exist anymore, right? We all know that colonization has happened everywhere and has removed a lot of these sacred truths from us. But there were people, you know, strong people who kept these things alive, even to their detriment, in secret, hiding, and who were just waiting for the day where they could share this knowledge. And I for one, feel really super blessed. And I know a lot of you who've learned these sacred ways feel super blessed by it. It has truly brought some beautiful moments to the families that I've worked with and to me personally. So I just wanted to make sure that we took time to chat about that too. So definitely please do your research before you ever decide to use these things. Do not go on YouTube and watch a video by some rando who's like, hey, buy my product and here's how you use it. No, that's not enough. That's not enough. Put your due diligence in, pay the right people for the right product and respect it. Okay, let's move on to warmth. So we talked a little bit about this hot and cold states. I put in your documents some links that you can follow to learn a little bit about more about that. And that's like a whole nother topic, but just, you know, keeping the mother and birthing or birthing parent warm, both inside and through ritual hot herbal baths, therapeutic yoni and V-steams. Again, we're using herbs, we're using water and vapor and heated stones and all of these lovely things that are not only a physical external application, but also an internal application to heal. Okay. And family community, bringing together the birthing person support network to both help the new and birthing person celebrate the new baby with music, dance, good food, and other rituals. You're probably like, what? Music? What? Dance? Rituals? What are you talking about? Ask me some questions about that. I'm happy to answer. I'm moving on to prepping for the next soup. Fire away. When you hear the word ritual, are you okay with it? Are you triggered by it? Are you thinking I'm a witch? Maybe I am. Jessie's shaking their head no. What do you think, Jessie?
About rituals?
Yeah.
I think they're a great addition to like someone's birth experience. I create yoni steams and I like to make them like a ritual for like women in postpartum, or even just like women who are trying to like heal from sexual trauma, or like any type of womb healing that's trying to be done. I like for it to be like ceremonious and like ritualistic for them.
Yeah.
So yeah, I like the ritual.
Thank you for speaking to the yoni.
Yeah.
Could you just briefly describe what a yoni steam is for somebody who may not know, and what yoni means or V-steam?
Yeah, so yoni is a Sanskrit word for womb space. And it is like yoni steams are like basically you get herbs to treat whatever aliment is trying to be treated, and you boil them and you steep them and then you sit over it and you allow the steam to permeate the vagina. It's traditionally used in many, many cultures for like postpartum healing, but you can use it for like balancing your pH balance, for like to help support and tightening your vaginal walls. It's good for like anybody who has experienced a tear with childbirth, because it sterilizes that. It can help aid in like healing from sexual trauma.
Thank you, that was a beautiful share.
Yeah.
And thank you for also mentioning, even though, you know, most of us here are birth workers and we're dealing with, you know, directly with birth or postpartum folks, yoni steam can be done at any time by any person, and you actually do not have to have a womb.
Yeah,
exactly. And yeah, so I'm actually one of those folks. About 12 years ago, I had a full abdominal hysterectomy because of 25 plus years of menstrual challenges. And when I first learned about yoni steam, I thought I wasn't a candidate. I thought I wasn't allowed to have it, you know? I thought it just wasn't gonna be either beneficial or something that could support me in any way, because I didn't have a womb anymore. And I was really sensitive about that and, you know, still processing emotionally that loss, even though it was like such a bittersweet thing. Like I was really happy not to have it anymore. And yet, you know, I really missed it. But I actually had my very first yoni steam because I was given permission by my mentor, my Malaysian mentor. And she said, just come and sit. Just, this will still be beneficial to you. And you have womb space. Yeah. You may not have a womb, but you have womb space. And you're still a woman. And these herbs are still beneficial to you, even externally to the, you know, to the vagina, to the labia, to the perineum. These are wonderful things. And, you know, hormonally also, you still have hormones, whether or not you have a womb or even ovaries, you have the space and it is rightfully yours. And that was such a gift to me that day. I really felt so special and it really brought together for me, like how important this is. And this was a ritual that many cultures across the world utilized, not only for like healing or whatever, but like as a way of gathering, like a gathering of women, you know? And this was a time for them to talk and to share and to nurture one another. If any of you have read the book or seen the movie, The Red Tent, that's what I always think about, right? That time away from all the men folk or away from all of the masculine, you know, toxic masculinity and all of the worries of the world and the worries of motherhood or whatever else might be upon you. So yeah, thank you so much. And what does that have to do with today? Again, it's just warming. And it's in the vein of cooking. I always think like, I feel like a kitchen witch all the time when I'm making my yoni steams. I'm like, put a little dash of this in, put a little sprinkle of that in, mix it all up in my big copper bowl that I got from Mexico. And I create my throne scene. I'll share some pictures with you guys later. If they aren't already in the document, I can't remember which ones I shared. Or if you go to my website or Facebook, you'll see some of those too. But yeah, absolutely, absolutely. So we're going to move on. As our stock is going, we can get things prepped for our Malaysian Sarawak Laksa soup. So we're going to use some chicken. Once we have our chicken ready, we're going to pull that out. We're going to shred it or dice it. It's really up to you how you want to do that. We're going to use some Sarawak Laksa paste. Basically, this is any kind of chili paste. And so at the bottom of that recipe, I said, if you can't find it, here's what you can try instead. Chili paste, shrimp paste, red or green Thai curry paste. Probably one of those things you either have in your pantry or refrigerator. If you have access to an Asian market, you can get, or the Asian food aisle at a grocery store, a good grocery store. You could probably find one of these substitutes and you can mix and match too. And you'll see that today. Yes, OMG, yum. Yes, yes, yes. So, again, I moved from the Seattle area. In Seattle, I had, after 8 years of living there, 9 years, I had just found all my stores, all my spices, and I brought as much as I could with me, but this was one thing I forgot to bring, and I used it all, and I couldn't find it here, so we'll do a little something different. We're also going to do 8 to 10 prawns. I want you to keep just the tails on, but you're going to save out the shells when you devein them and shell them. Throw the veins away. Those are poop tracks. We don't want poop tracks in our food, and we don't even want it for stock. We just want the shells, the hard shells. And that's actually going to create like a fish broth on top of the chicken broth that we already have made. Okay. We're going to use some unsweetened coconut milk, ginger, galangal, lemongrass. We're going to do a dash of either soy or aminos, liquid aminos. It's basically soy sauce without the soy. I love it. Kids prefer it. Just make sure there's no MSG if you're cooking for a postpartum person. So you're gonna have to be really careful and do a lot of label reading. MSG is, unfortunately, it's a preservative and it's in a lot of things. If you just cannot get around it, please use it very, very, very sparingly, okay? We're going to use sesame oil. You hear some of the things that we talked about being lactogenic and warming. We're going to make a little omelet and we're going to cut it up and we're going to serve all these little garnishes on top of it. So those of you who love ramen, ramen soup, like not top ramen, but like ramens, good ramens with all the little toppings and fixins. This is going to be like that. For garnish, we're going to do some bean sprouts. If you like those, I happen to hate them, so I did not get any. Fried or dried shallots. We're going to do green onion, chilies, cilantro. We're going to have some limes. So in much of Eastern cooking, we try to do the sweet, the sour, the spicy. So we're trying to get all of those taste buds, like everywhere, you know, in your palate is going to have this awakening, this pop. Yeah, so it's going to be a full scale, like amazing soup. Okay, so we're going to start that one in a large pot. I'm going to go ahead and cook up my veggies and start my little egg. While I'm doing that, from what I understand, it is an artificial compound. Oh, MSG? Yep.
Yes. Yeah, I was just going to say, we're asking about why is MSG considered harmful in postpartum? I mean, absolutely. Just in general, really, but yeah, especially for postpartum.
Yeah. Yep. Thank you for sharing that. So I'd love to do a bio break right now. I see Jesse. Thank you, Jesse, or somebody else. Do you want to lead a little bio break for everybody while I transition over to the stove? Do some stretching, take a potty break, get yourself a drink. I've got some herbal sun tea out cooking in the New Mexico heat and sun. I lost you. Let's see.
I am actually going to use the bathroom, but Lo is a stretch queen.
you guys are just passing off all the. No, just kidding. No, for sure. I got you. Okay. Yeah. So, yeah, if you just want to stand up and just stretch your legs a little bit, like kick them out, roll your ankles counterclockwise, clockwise, do the same thing with your shoulders, rolling them back. And rolling them forward, doing some rotations with your neck and your head, going clockwise or going counterclockwise, and just wiggle your body out, let those muscles loosen up, make sure you get some water. If you need to just jog in place a little bit, wake yourself up, do that too, it's awesome.
I'm gonna refill my drink today too. And what I've got is actually, this one is my prickly pear. So I know I'm a chef, but there are some things that like I've never seen or like had in person before. I've had prickly pear before, but I'd never seen a real prickly pear like out in the wild.
Oh yeah.
Until 3 days ago, we went on a hike and I found one. I was like, oh my gosh, a prickly pear.
Oh yay, that's awesome. Oh, I gotta come down there and visit you guys.
Yeah, I know, right? We need to go harvest. But here's the deal. So like on the pad of the nopal, the cactus, yeah, there's prickles. Like you're like, oh, okay, prickly pear comes from, but the pear itself has tiny little hairs that are prickly and you can't see those very well, or at least I didn't. And so I went and grabbed it. And it was like I had gotten shot by a porcupine. I had like all these prickles on my first two fingers and I'm like trying to pull them out. Oh, I didn't have any tweezers with me, but I got my prickly pear. Got my prickly pear. Anyway, this one is prickly pear juice that I bought pre-made. And I make like a lemonade and then add it to it. And it's just so pretty. I use hibiscus flowers too as like a nice cooling drink.
Okay.
So what I mean by cooling is like some moms, even though we know they're like in a state of cold, they're like not having this hot beverage all day long. Like I freaking want just like, at the very least, give me something lukewarm if you can't put ice in it. Cause I kind of like, I don't refuse, but I'm like, I'd rather not put ice in it for you. I'm the ice queen though. I'm always hot. Because I'm menopausal, so I'm getting ice in mine, but hibiscus and the prickly pear and watermelon, like, yes, those are cooling fruits, like for doshas and stuff, but if you have a person who wants it, just hydrate them, Coconut right. water actually is cooling as well, but we know that it's fantastic for hydrating, and a lot of breastfeeding, chest feeding parents are dehydrated by the time we get to
for
them.
Sure.
So freaking just give them something. It's better than nothing. And let's just amend, and let's just be, you know, like, I try not to be too rigid. I let them know what my thoughts are, what my processes are, mm-hmm. where I found my knowledge from. But ultimately we let them choose, and we help them make the best choices we can. So I'm going to grab my ice, and then we're going to start throwing stuff in the pot.
Awesome.
All right, for this dish, I'm going to start with some sesame oil. And I'm going to do a bit of avocado oil. So that sesame oil is warming, and the avocado oil, avocados, great, healthy option. And imparts good flavor. So now that I've got that in, I'm going to do half the carrots, saving the rest for my other soup. So like we talked a little bit about meal prepping. So if I know I'm doing two recipes that day that have onions in it, why would I like just chop onions for one, stop, restart chopping onions for a second one, right? Just do it all at once, split it up. There you go. I'm going to get that, so I don't have the laksa paste. So here's what we're using today instead. Sriracha. Probably almost everybody in America now has sriracha in their refrigerator. It's like the new ketchup, right? It's a hot sauce of
yum.
Choice of most folks. So I'm going to do a roasted chili paste that I found that has shrimp paste in it. So I used to have shrimp paste, that was another thing. Surprisingly, I could not just find plain shrimp paste at the Asian market. Yes, I do a lot of things with my teeth. So I'm just gonna take about one heaping tablespoon. Put just a little touch of sriracha down in there, and then we're really just going to use this for garnish later, or to heat it up a little more, spice it up a little more. And then I also have a red chili paste, or sorry, a red curry paste, and I'll use that as well. Oh my gosh, it's so fragrant. So one of the things I've done, like when I've done online cooking classes or like cooking classes where people couldn't really get that close, I'm like, through the magic of television, I'm like, I wish you had smell-o-vision and you could smell how good it smells in here. And I also do the Julia Child thing where, like, I don't know if you've ever watched her, like any cooking show, they're like, they have a raw chicken 1 second and they go to commercial break and suddenly they pull out of the second drawer. It's like this beautifully 45 minute cooked chicken, and you know it was done ahead of time by their assistants. So yeah, we might be doing a little bit of that today. I'll just take my wooden spoon. I love to use wooden spoons. Like, my kids are all about plastic, and I tried to change over all my plastic to what's that other material called?
Bamboo.
Silicone.
Oh, silicone.
Yeah, so it's like you're not getting PVCs or whatever in the food.
I just did the same thing.
Yeah, it's not cheap, but dollar store has like 3 wooden spoons for $1. So like, and they last, I mean, they get pretty stained up and everything, but I'm like, well, then I know it doesn't have varnish on it if it's getting stained. And like, who remembers their grandmother's big wooden spoons? They probably whacked you with it too, maybe. Yeah, mine did. But she also cooked really good food with it, so we forgave her. Bamboo, so anyways,
bamboo's really good. It doesn't get stained.
Yes, I have a few of the nicer bamboo. Actually, I think I'm using the bamboo one now. You can tell because you can see the little striations in it. And this is my like dollar store cheapie, but I still love this one because it's narrow enough to fit in small jars and get stuff out. Who sees the recipe? Could you read off what comes after? Oh, let's do our coconut milk, right? Let me go grab that. And somebody read off the ingredients to me. Little tip, I always shake my coconut milk because the cream will rise to the top and then it's like you can't get it out. It like causes a little spot. Does anybody have the recipe in front of them that they could read?
Yes. So after coconut milk, it's 1 teaspoon fresh or powdered ginger, 1 teaspoon fresh or powdered galangal. I don't know if I'm saying that right.
Then
1 teaspoon fresh or powdered lemongrass, salt and pepper, dash of amino acids or soy sauce, and then 2 tablespoons sesame oil.
Okay, perfect. Did you say turmeric? I can't remember if I have that in this one.
No.
Oh, galangal. That's what you said. Okay, perfect. Yeah.
What is that?
What's that?
What's galangal?
It looks like ginger. Okay. It's like a root. Yeah.
Mm-hmm.
I usually get it powdered because it's really hard to find. I'm looking for it right now. Well, I think I might have it out. Okay, so if you've ever made like a curry, you're gonna recognize, you're gonna recognize what we got going on in the pot. It smells super, super yummy right now. So I've got some water on to heat behind that, and I'm gonna throw my vermicelli rice noodles in, and it's just 2 minutes. It's just like a quick flash. We wanna get them softened up, and then we're gonna drain them. Some people even like to plunge them in cold water to stop what we call carryover cooking, which is when the heat continues to cook it. Toss those in. And it looks like our stock is done. So usually I'm going straight from having my stock in like mason jars and like pouring it into something. Today we're just gonna ladle it in. So I don't know what size your noodles come in. Mine is like this big old hunk. I'm only gonna use half of this. But if you're a noodle fiend, by all means do more. This one came in a really long bunch. Usually they're like pre-cut. So we're gonna have to be creative there. Okay. So now we're gonna do our omelet. So I'm gonna let this just kind of go on low for a minute. And I'm gonna get my little frying pan. I'm gonna put a bit of sesame oil down in there. And just whisk 2 eggs together with a little soy. All right. Anybody have any questions we can chat about? For their
I'm curious, how do you feel about, or do you encourage foraged items?
Forage? Is that what you said?
Yeah. How do you feel about foraging?
Oh, forage.
Yes.
I was like, porridge, yes. And forage, yes. But my one thing is like, do not forage for mushrooms. Please do not forage for mushrooms without like having taken several classes and being very, very well aware, or going with somebody who is a mushroom forager. I don't know what they're called, what their name is, but yeah, that's like a little dicey for me. And then also berries are really dicey for me, and greens. So maybe that's a lot of things are a little bit dicey. Like, just really do your due diligence, check and recheck with books, check online. There's also apps you can get where you can click a picture of something and find out what it is and if it's safe to eat. Does anybody else have any like thoughts about that?
I do. So chaga can be a pretty easy one to learn how to identify and where not to find it. Like, it only grows on birch trees, for example. And then always looking for dangerous lookalikes, learning what those are for whatever it is that you are learning to identify. And then what was another thing? Yeah, I love the apps thing. Although always, I would say, be 100, there's always the rule of thumb, be 100% sure that what you're looking at is what you think or hope that it is, because of course it can be risky, as is proven by the fact that we're talking about this, or I guess demonstrated by that. Yep. There's another thing, but I like woke up late today, so I've got brain fog. Yeah, I guess those are the main things that come to mind, and I'll mention in the chat if I think of any others. There are some greens that are pretty easy to find.
Dandelion.
And then it can be really, yes. Although there are even some that look like that too, but maybe they're not harmful. I'd have to check, like a certain kind of aster. I don't remember. Yeah, even if you're using an app though, remember that it is not 100% accurate. And yeah, learning the lookalikes, I think, is one of the biggest thing. And then especially if you can learn like the different, various terms that are used, like terminology when identifying things. And I don't know. Yeah, I love to forage things, but definitely agree that it's important to be really sure that you're looking at what you think or hope you're looking at. Yes. And also seeing it from a good place, like not next to railroad tracks or not next to the road, which if you're asking about for it, I'm guessing you know about already. But yeah, those sorts of things.
I would just say from a business perspective also, like I would not serve a client something I foraged more than likely.
Yep.
Yeah. I just don't want to be responsible for, it's just not. I'm not enough of an expert, and like, I just don't want to take that risk at all.
Totally. Yep. I would only use those things that I mentioned, and forging in general, personally, for my own stuff. There's definitely the huge liability factor. It's hard enough when you're cooking for someone with regular ingredients to make sure that you're choosing all the right things, and then to add that layer on top. I mean, like if you specialize in herbalism and have some sort of certification, I don't really know the scope of practice there, but maybe it'll be different. But for a lot of us, it's probably off the table, just prudently.
Thank you for bringing that up.
Yeah.
I'm just checking my soup. I'm going to put it on for a few more minutes just to get that. That was pretty plump chicken I had in there. One of the things that I mentioned about chicken as well is that besides, you know, being organic, free range, all of that good stuff, if we can also make sure that it's a young chicken. So in particularly Asian countries, they really specify that we use a younger chicken. And I've actually never found out why that is a thing. I just know that it is, and so I follow it. Does anybody happen to have?
It's more tender.
Yeah, it's more tender.
More tender? That's it. It's not about like a stage or hormones or anything like that. Okay. Awesome. Thank you.
It can be when it's mass produced, like if you're buying it from the grocery store, then yes, it is about hormones to plump up the chickens. But if you're farm raising yours, it's because the meat is more tender, you just don't get as much meat. So you're using more chickens, if that makes sense.
It does. Thank you. Yeah, so we got a young chicken today. She's a young one. All right. Oops. Sorry. Clicked off by accident. There we go. What was that? Oh, that's an email. Okay, so my omelet's doing its thing. So I don't know if any of you have ever lived high altitude or you're in high altitude right now, but I just came from the coast and I'm from the East Coast. I was living on the West Coast at, what do you call it? What's that called? Sea level. And so now I'm more than a mile high. And so everything has changed for me, cooking, especially baking, and like things take forever to cook here. Even with a gas range, which I haven't had in a while, it's just like, hurry up and cook already. So I didn't change any of the recipes. You'll just have to adjust if you're high altitude. It's just gonna take longer, you know, for everything. So, all right, let's go to one of our lessons while we're sitting here. Let's talk a little bit about atolls. I know I'm shifting gears here, but I want to try to make sure we have time to get some of those done. So the history of atolls. Atolls come from what we call Mesoamerica, which is typically known as Mexico, Central America, okay? And even the islands. And atole is the Spanish word for Nahuatl word, which is, I mean, I don't know how they pronounced it, so I'm not even gonna try, but it's a Nahuatl word, which is Northern Mexican. It's a warming beverage, and the main element is typically maize, which is corn, or maize, we say here. It typically includes corn hominy flour, water, something called piloncillo. Who's Hispanic or who knows what piloncillo is? Can you tell us?
Me.
Okay.
It's like that, it's like a cone of like sugar.
Yep.
Traditionally found like at like Hispanic markets or like in Mexico.
Yep.
Yeah. My mom used to use it for a lot of different things. So
yes.
Use it for a bunch of different things.
Yeah, so piloncillo is, it does typically come in cones, although I have seen it in squares too. And it's really just cane sugar. So it's like molasses flavor, that darker sugar that hasn't been refined into white sugar. It's like, you know, the closest thing to raw that you can get basically. So therefore that's why a lot of people use it. And so when we're talking about organic and things that are less processed and, you know, white sugar is bleached, how do you think they get it white? It's brown. So, you know, we want to use some of those more natural things in natural states. So atolls are going to utilize the, sorry, let me turn this down. They're going to utilize the piloncillo as the main form of sweetening it. Although there are savory versions of these warming drinks. If you think about like an oatmeal or a porridge consistency, grits, if you've had grits before, it can go anywhere from that thicker, like puddingy version to like a very watered down milky version and anywhere in between. It's really each family has a different recipe. Each person likes a different consistency. So we can adjust. We can adjust that. And we can also adjust the flavors. We can also adjust which staple we're going to be using in it. So as I said, maize or corn is the main staple, but we can also substitute that for rice flour or rice. We can substitute it for oats, amaranth. I mean, really the sky is the limit. So typically, sorry, I lost you again. Let's try, get back on. Okay, here we go. So, they used to toast the masa, whatever grain they were using, on a griddle called a comal. Some people don't toast it. They'll just use it in whatever form it comes in the bag. Most markets and grocery stores are going to carry one of the staple ingredients that you're going to need. And usually it was water that was added to it. But when the Spanish came, they brought with them cows and milk. And so they sort of substituted the water for milk to make it like a creamier version. But if you are Latin American or it's like non-European, you are more than likely lactose intolerant. And so we like to keep it traditional. You can substitute that cow's milk for any kind of milk. I'm gonna be using almond today. I've used coconut milk before. Oat milk is fantastic. So just feel free when I say milk to use any kind of milk that you like, or water, or both. So it's really a comfort food, but it also has curative properties. And we know today that those curative properties come from the type of grain and the warming ingredients that we add to it. It was really used for when people were ill as well to restore their health, and always in the postpartum. Traditionally, that very first week, it's mostly atoles, porridges, and very light broths with maybe just rice or maybe a noodle. Everything's going to be fairly bland and easy to digest, because we know that everything shifts and the digestive tract is very impacted after delivery. So we want to really keep those foods restorative, warming, but not spicy and not hard to digest, okay, during that first week. And then as we transition through the rest of the weeks of recovery, then we start adding in new things. Let's see. Oh yeah, it was also used for energy. So the laborers would like drink this throughout the day to have extra energy and calories. So you can see why in the postpartum, this is a fantastic beverage to be able to share with our families. So traditional midwives, they obviously knew that this was the best way to support the nutritional needs of the mothers, the birthing people. And it also is very lactogenic. And so it's gonna enhance milk production, and it's a great source of protein. So very diverse history throughout the Americas. It's known, you know, culturally, medicinally, and gastronomically now. So the first one we're going to make in just a little bit is atole de maíz, or corn. And I'm going to show you some of the ingredients to get prepared for that. So red mill makes a masa harina. Do not use cornstarch or corn flour. It has to be masa harina. I was really lucky moving to New Mexico. I found blue corn, and it's an atole packet. So yeah, and it even has the directions on the back. So I think I'm gonna make that today. I'm really excited. Here's the piloncillo we were talking about. It comes in a little cone. I mean, I've seen people use the whole thing in it. I find it very, very sweet. So I use less, and I'll also use sweetener alternatives. So I'll use agave, I'll use a pure maple syrup. I'll even put like orange blossom syrup in it, or rose blossom syrup in it. Then we have like the toppings, so to speak, and I'm such a topping person. I'm like, get that cinnamon in there, nutmeg, clove, cardamom. I'll do cacao powder, or I'll shave a real nice dark chocolate. I'll use my microblade. Take that chocolate right over the top. Chopped nut, any kind of nut you want. And then we were talking about the milks. So I love almond and oat. That's mostly what my clients really enjoy. But you know, it's really up to you. A coconut milk too, we love coconut milk. So every day of the week, you can imagine you could make a different atole. And there are atoles that are chocolate, like think of a hot chocolate porridge. And those are called champurana. Has anybody ever had a champurrada here? I'm just letting this. Oh, you're welcome, Andy. You've had champurrada? So good, right? So if you've ever had a traditional Mexican hot chocolate, the Aztec version actually has chili peppers in it. So it's spicy, it's definitely warming. With the champurrada, it's really gonna be more of just the chocolate. You're not necessarily gonna put the chili peppers in it, although really you could if the person you're making it for would enjoy that. But it's just, I mean, just think of like warm chocolate pudding that's like stick to your ribs, like fill your mouth, delicious. So, 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 so good. And the chocolate I use for that is Abuelita. Who's had Abuelita hot chocolate? So simple, right? Yes, make a pot of it. Like through the winter, we will go through, I don't even know how many boxes, like 10 boxes. Now they make it in powdered form, so like my kids can make it themselves and I'm not sitting over the stove like kitchen witching it with my molinillo. Anybody seen one of these before? Fancy Mexican whisk, but you're basically gonna go like this and you see these carved wooden rings, they create the froth. So with a champurrada, it's more than likely gonna be too thick, just depending that you're not gonna use your molinillo, but you'll use like a traditional whisk, but you could definitely use this. Okay, so I was gonna show you, let me get something off the stove, I'll be right back. Okay, so what's really nice about the Abuelita, besides like being the perfect chocolate and already having like cinnamon and sugar in it, oh my gosh, it smells so good, is it comes like you can pre-cut it into just these little bars. So like if you're making a small pot just for one or two, or you're making like a whole family's worth, do the whole thing in it. Okay, so we'll start those in a little bit. Let's come back over to our main area. All right. So our omelet is ready. We're going to slice that up because that's one of our toppings. And we need some green onions for our toppings. We're still working on that Malaysian laksa soup. So I've got my green onion. Again, everything's pre-washed. Cut off the bottom. If there are any like gross little tops, I'm just gonna pull those off. I'm gonna put them in my bowl for later. I'm gonna take them, line them up. And then cut them in these little shreds here. I'm gonna do the same thing with my cilantro. And I didn't have any red chili peppers, so, you know what I did get? Thai basil, oh, so fragrant. It smells a little bit like licorice, like it's basil on steroids, and I love it. So when we have a big leaf like this, we're gonna roll it up, and it's called a chiffonade. So once it's rolled, then you're gonna take and go through like that. And it makes these like strips that are really pretty. So I'll just have like a few different things here and there. Get a little bit of cilantro. So I don't know if it's like laziness or like just in Peru we do this. We use stems and all. Like we just pick it, like we'll twist it off and just start chopping it. But like a friend of mine who's also a doula chef, she's like, no, my Mexican mother-in-law said, you only pick the leaves off and you never serve the stems. So like you make that choice for yourself. I'll use that as a garnish, but like if I'm cooking, I'm just chopping the whole thing up. How about you guys? Do you guys have any tricks or tips? I'm gonna grab our omelet. right, so here's our omelet. Does anybody do stuff like this for their noodle bowls at home?
Yes, definitely.
Yeah, right? I mean, and really, you could get like your 30-cent packet of ramen and jazz it up. You really don't have to go to like some fancy place to have it. Make it yourself. All right. So again, you could do the bean sprouts. I've got some dried shallots here. Just do a little pinch of those. They smell yummy. And let me get that. Let's check on our broth. So I'm gonna use some long tongs. Oh, I've got my noodles ready. I'm gonna use the tongs to get my bouquet garni out. And it's gonna go. Drip it out, put it into your sieve. We're gonna take this chicken. And I put my chicken in a big Pyrex or cake dish with high sides, because you know, it's still gonna be really drippy. And I'll stick my tongs in its rear end and just pull that sucker right out.
Girl.
Right?
What you make?
Why is beans?
Right. I'm gonna let that cool for a second. And now I'm gonna get my canning jar. And I'm gonna get my little canning funnel and I'm gonna ladle some into here. Straight from the stock. I am not straining that puppy. No reason to. We want all the bits and goodies.
Oh boy.
Yeah, so again, throughout Latin America and in the East, we value the fat on the chicken. We value the marrow. We value everything that comes out of it. That's all good stuff. That's the restorative stuff. If you buy chicken stock in a box or a can or whatever, that's been strained of all of those nutrients and good fats and everything. And I'm not saying like, eat this every day like this, eat the skin all the time. But during the postpartum or when you're ill, it's incredibly important. That's where all the nutrients are. So trust me on this. Now you're gonna have some people who are like, ew, I don't like the skin. If you can talk them into just a little bit of it, like hide it in the soup, they'll eat it, it'll be fine. Sometimes they just like the skin a little bit crispier. So you can peel the skin off and then go like fry it up a little bit in a good oil or just fry it up on its own. Or you can omit it, obviously. All right, so I'm getting those 7 to 8 cups of cooking liquid that I need for my Malaysian soup. I'm just gonna pour it directly in there with that curry paste base that I started. I need a camera crew, by the way.
Monica, I'm going to do a little time check. We're coming up on noon here Pacific time, but I would love for you to finish. So whoever can stay on is welcome. I am not rushing off either. So we'll just, let's see the final product.
Thank you so much. So let's go ahead and just make this soup up. And I'm so sorry that it's taken me so long. This is the first time I've tried to attempt to do so many things at once. But I hope you got enough information, and with the recipes and as we talk through everything, you'll feel confident to do these things on your own. I'm gonna go ahead and plate up the Malaysian soup that we were able to create today so that you can see that. And if people do want, did you say if they wanted to stay on a little bit longer, they could, or? Okay, awesome. So maybe we'll do one atole. So let me go get the bowl. Got my cute little bowl here. And I love it because it came with its own chopsticks and the little side of the bowl notch so you can rest them in there. So I'm gonna put down my noodles first. Get our tongs. I'm gonna fill the bowl up about probably a third of the way with noodles. We're not making this like predominantly noodles, we're making this predominantly broth. I'm gonna pour over finished broth. Beautiful color. Try to get some of those vegetables from the bottom, those little gems. There we go. Let's start putting on our toppings. So we'll do and I've got the shrimp, they're pre-cooked. And I might do a little yin-yang, who knows? Just make it look pretty, put a few in there. Do a good protein. Dried shallot. And then a little bit of sriracha. Plate it. There we go. Final product. How yummy does that look? Smells that's so darn good. Yeah, we're gonna eat it for lunch later. Yay. Okay. So does it seem doable? Does it seem difficult? Like if you had to rate the level of cooking on that, what are your thoughts? What do you guys think?
I think that's a really good, like, kind of quick slow cook meal.
Yeah, quick slow cook. I like that. I'm gonna coin that term.
Yeah, I love it.
Awesome. Okay, well, let's move on to our atoles. If you guys want to turn to the atole recipe page, you're just going to call out for the corn atole, the recipe to me, if you wouldn't mind. And I'm going to go over to the stove again. We're going to do this just in a little pot, a little saucepan, nothing crazy. I mean, if you're doing it for everybody in the family, obviously you can go bigger, but all right. So I know I want to get my pilon seal in there and water to cook down first. Silencio. Okay, I'm gonna put that down in here, get some water. How many cups of water does it say?
Water or milk? Because I see 4 cups of milk.
Oh, yeah. For this one. Oh. Half water, half milk. What do you guys think? For the blue corn one, can we do almond? That sounds delish.
That sounds good.
Yeah. Oh, okay, this is a big no-no. I'm doing liquid measurement, liquid in a dry measurement cup because I used my other one, but there is a difference, but I'm going to pretend there isn't today and eyeball it. So I put 1 cup of water to 3 cups of milk. I'm going to put a dash of salt in. I'm going to use my pink Himalayan. It's going to bring out those flavors. Again, it's going to have some trace minerals in it. Stick. And I lost my jar of cinnamon sticks. So we are, oh, maybe I didn't. Hold on. I swear I'm like missing half my stuff. It's still in storage. Okay, so I'm just gonna pour a little bit of cinnamon in. That's fine too. Although a cinnamon stick, like, it just has something different about it. I don't know what it is. I guess because it hasn't lost, like, you know, herbs and spices over time, they lose their essential oils, like potency. So that stick, it just holds its potency so well. All right, so once I've got this heated over the saucepan, you know, once the sugar is dissolved fairly well, then we're going to take out the cinnamon stick, which we don't have one, so we don't need to worry about it. I'm gonna make the warm water and masa harina mixture in a separate bowl. Although I will tell you, I have gone straight into the pan. I don't know if anybody else has before, and just like cook the whole thing together. Actually, if you don't mind, I'm just gonna do that. Does anybody mind if I'm going off script a little bit?
Not at all.
So we're going to do about a half a cup, but I'm going to save extra out. So I'm going to do the whole half a cup. I actually went 3/4 cup because I'm going to adjust the consistency. If I need to make it thinner or thicker, then I will. I'm going to use my wooden spoon for the first part of this, and then I'll whisk later. So I'll just have both of those as an option. And I've got my heat on high right now. What I don't want to do is I don't want to scorch. So milk obviously can scorch pretty easily and sugar can burn. So this is really a matter of just like finding something, humming a song in your head, thinking happy thoughts as you're cooking, while you're cooking, because you're going to be sitting over the stove for a few minutes to make this. So that's cooking down. Has anybody had a tole before? And if so, what kind and what did you put in it?
I have not had it before, but I have heard of it.
Yeah, super popular.
I am so excited to try this. Totally.
Hey, if anybody can't find the blue corn tole, I will totally send it to you. Just let me know. Most of you have my email now. Or you can put your email in the chat. Oh, sorry, Daniela. Sorry I'm running so late. De nada, de nada. She said, muchas gracias, thank you. And I said, de nada, you're welcome. Okay, so, I mean, I'm still at a pretty thin consistency here, but it's definitely gonna thicken, like exactly like when you're making that jello pudding over the stove. It takes a bit, but it gets there. Some people do add corn starch to it as a thickener, And those are just various family recipes. I'm not into that. Like, I'd rather just sit here and cook it. But, you know, just a thought while we're doing this, I was talking about like sing a little song or have a happy thought. You know, food is a medium to feelings. I truly believe that. And I don't know if you've, you know, like you've gone to a certain restaurant or like somebody grouchy has cooked you a meal or like you haven't really felt it. You taste that in the food. That comes across. Like it goes from your head through your body into your spoon, down into the food, or like textually, tactilely as you're making that. But conversely, like when you know something was made with love and care and dedication and good thoughts were put into that, that is the most delicious food. And it could be the simplest thing on earth. Like I think about my grandmother. She was actually also a chef late in life. When she was in her 40s, she went back to school and became a culinary, you know, she went to the Culinary Arts Institute and became a chef. And I just grew up at her apron strings, so to speak. And she would make bread, and it was like the most simple white bread, literally white bread recipe, but it was the most delicious thing on earth. Because I can remember her just like humming and like, you know, kneading it and taking her time, and it was different stages and like checking the oven periodically and like knowing from the smell, like that it was ready. Like she didn't need a timer. She didn't need anybody to tell her this is the color, the consistency, the rise, anything. Like she just knew. And that's one of those things, like my husband can't understand it. He puts pizza pockets in and has it on a timer. I'm like, you'll know when the pizza pockets are done. You'll just know. Yes, yes, Lizzie, it is related to emotional. Absolutely. You know, all the work that we do is. And that's why, you know, most of us were trained. If we had good trainers, they said, like, leave your baggage at home. Don't bring that crap into a birthing suite or somebody's home. Like, that's their sacred space, and you need to make the space theirs. And you need to give them what you have. Like, obviously we can have boundaries, right? But I feel like birth work is truly passion work, and it's from the heart if you got into it for the right reasons and you continue to do it for the right reasons. And yeah, there's just no room for that negativity to come in. Just like, if you need to be late and sit in your car and get a good cry out, scream, yell, whatever you have to do to get it out before you come into their space. Don't bring it in with you. And like, speaking of birth work, I was thinking also, I was reading recently about bringing your own birth traumas to a birth, and like how, even if you're verbally, you're not vocalizing like, oh my gosh, this happened to me and this happened to me and like, it was horrible and oh my God, you know, like all of those things, like that energy, that vibe you're bringing can actually affect how that person will not only transition through their stages, but if they'll have to have more interventions. It's crazy how we can manifest that. We can either manifest for the good, or we can manifest, unfortunately, for the negative. And like me personally, I was like, oh, that won't be a problem for me. I never gave birth. But what I didn't realize on my very first birth is how emotional I would be seeing somebody give birth. And yes, it is still emotional to this day. And I know it's not about me and my feelings. Like, it's just such a joyous, beautiful occasion. Like, you cry happy tears. But I realized on that very first birth, like, I had never witnessed birth. I had never been through birth before. I'd only watched like videos, and that's not the same as being in that room. But I knew, like, I was superimposing the fact that I hadn't had that experience on somebody else's experience. And you can't take that back, you know? Like, I hope that they didn't feel that, and I don't think they knew that about me. But at the same time, yeah, we just have to be so careful. We really have to cultivate a beautiful space for people. So this is probably going to take a little bit longer than most of you have. I'm probably about 5 to 10 more minutes away from getting this to a thicker consistency, but I'll show you what it looks like, and we'll go ahead and make some toppings, and I will be the official taste tester of the blue corn for you. So let me go grab my mug. So I'll show you my two mugs. This is my big old mug. This is for like atoles. And then this is for the champurrada, the chocolate, because I find that the chocolate you kind of can only do in a smaller dose. Like some people will guzzle a big old one down and ask for more, but other people are like, yeah, I'm good with just the, it's like a shot, you know, of really good liquor. You just need a shot. So we're using the big one for the regular atole today. It smells so good. And like, it has this lovely, I'll have to show you in a minute, lovely color. And it's still got some of the graininess, which I really enjoy. That's the reason I like oatmeal. Yeah, thank you. Yeah, Talavera. I mean, this is the cheaper version. I got it at, it's kind of like this outdoor market here. I think they're like, I know $7 a piece or something like that, which in a way felt expensive, but then in a way, you know, you think about like how much time it took to paint these and everything. Okay. So I am a cinnamon fiend. So any atole or hot chocolate that I ever have is always going to have cinnamon on top. But I love this idea of the chopped nuts. And I've personally never done chopped nuts on top, so I'm going to do that today. And I always do a warming spice besides the cinnamon. So cardamom is just a super lovely spice. And we often think of cardamom as being more of like a savory spice. But I will tell you, every atole I've made for every client, when I slip in that cardamom, they're like, what is that? That's so amazing. Like, I don't recognize it. I'm like, that's your cardamom. But it's sweeten, you know, it's in a sweet application. Okay, so I'm gonna do my cinnamon, and I'm gonna microblade my abuelita. Oh yeah, I mean, not quite champurrada, but okay, they definitely toasted it, so it's got this like, oh my gosh, this really nice nutty toast. I didn't even put the nuts in, but it tastes nutty. So I'm gonna do some pecans. So like, if this is the only calories or warmth that birthing person is gonna get, it's all in here, right? It's all there. And then if you did a soup on top of that, and then if you had some of that chicken stock reserved in mason jars and they could just drink that like a tea. And then if you had like lactation teas for them and other warming teas, like I've got the Moroccan mint tea, I've got the Tanamera Malaysian tea with some like amazing ingredients in it. Like they're gonna stay hydrated. They're gonna be lactating well if they choose to. They're gonna be warmed. They're gonna be sustained. It's like, it's all good. And it's all in liquid form, which is what I really love. Now we need to do this in person. Yes. So thank you for saying that, Terry. I'm actually gonna be inviting people out to my home here. I've got a little casita that I'm setting up as like the office training space and a little cooking space. And it's a lot cooler in there. It's got like 3 foot thick walls. So in the middle of the summer, I won't be sweating buckets like I am in my home part of the kitchen right now. But I'd love to have you guys out. I'll have some other training videos that I'm gonna be setting up on the website. If anybody's interested, please just hit me up on Facebook. I'm Delish Chef Monica or Monica Villanueva Holmes. You can reach out to Terry or Lauren if you know them, or anybody else in the Seattle area can get a hold of me. And I want to create more community. I really want to like empower others. And I've been given the task by my mentors, my Moroccan and my Malaysian mentor were really, really passionate about moving this work forward. So like, I feel like I owe it to them and I owe it to the people of their countries, of their culture to share this. It was knowledge that was given to us to share. Hi, baby.
I love pumpkin. You got me with the baby.
Yes, in person for sure. It's really hard to do this online without like a camera person and like things staged and everything. But thank you guys for hanging in there. Buen provecho, that means like, you know, or well, in Spanish, in Peruvian Spanish, we say brindis or salud, whatever your word is for that. Thank you guys so much for joining today. If you didn't get the recipes and everything, please let me know and we'll send those out to you. And I know Terry's going to work on the recording.
Thank you so much.
Thank you so much, Monica.
Yeah, thank you.
That was incredible, and I can't wait to try your recipes. Village Circle is switching to monthly now, so the beginning of each month, we'll keep having these gatherings, and I can't wait to have you back, Monica. That was incredible.
Thank you so much. Thank you for letting me work out all the kinks. I really appreciate that, guys. You were so, you're so patient with me.
No kinks. No kinks. It was incredible.
Hi, baby. Madeline. Andy, what's baby's name?
Her name is Hadley, and she has her her kitty napping friend right now.
Is that your support kitty? Do you want to see my doggies? They're all under my table. Love that. They're under my table. Let's say hi. Hi, puppy.
Oh my gosh. Hi. They're so sweet.
Oh, here they come. Here's mama.
Oh my gosh. My gorgeous babies.
They were waiting.
And they found the perfect spot for snacks. Yep.
They were just like, oh yeah, please drop that carrot. I'll eat it. Yeah. Yesterday they had a tomato and they thought it was a ball. And she took a bite of it and her little face was like, whoa, that's not a plastic ball.
What is that?
Eat it up. Well, thanks that's again, so funny. Guys.
Our dogs are scrap dogs now and they're so spoiled that they won't even touch carrots anymore. They're like, no, I'm gonna wait for the good chicken.
Wait for the drizzle to fall on the ground.
Yeah. Oh, thank you so much. Thank you.
Bye, guys. Take care, everybody.
Bye.
So
good to meet everyone.
Bye. Thank you, Monica.
Bye.